You don't want one of us to read Matthew 22. You don't want one of us to read Matthew 22 when the time is right.
Sure.
Yeah. Jeff and I are really happy to have Matt up here with us tonight. Of course, the Kleinwood family knows that this isn't the first time that we've sat down and had a conversation with Matt. In fact, I was kind of doing the math. Isn't it just about a year ago that we did our first conversation? Is that right?
Thereabouts. I think maybe a month earlier in May.
Yeah. I think that's right. So, and at that time, the focus of our conversation really was on the problem of suffering and some insights you had gained about suffering and death through the ordeal you were going through with your ALS. I know that tonight you were really eager to kind of take this conversation in a different direction. And so I want to give you a chance to kind of start that out. I know that that one of the things when you and I talked about this that you really emphasized is that you thought this ordeal that you have been through has really given you an opportunity to evaluate not just the end of your life, but how you have lived the life you've had as well. So why don't I let you kind of introduce that and take that direction you want to go with it.
That's exactly right, brother, because I am in kind of a unique position and have been for the past couple of years, because I have one of the few diagnoses that doesn't mean immediate death, but is a death sentence. There are drugs that can modestly extend the lifespans of people with ALS, but there is no cure. And that means that from the moment I was diagnosed, I knew I was terminal. Before that time, I had been a fit man with no bad habits like smoking or drinking, so I could reasonably expect another 40 years. But now, of course, I know that I am going to die in my mid-40s. That the life I have lived to this point is all the life I am going to get. And that means that you really go back and you really start evaluating the choices you have made. Okay, if I'm going to get 45 years, how have I done with my 45 years? And as I was engaged in taking stock, I found that I was really okay with that. I decided that the most important thing about life was not how long I lived, but how I lived. And there were things that I remembered doing that led me to say, yes, that was worth doing. That was the kind of life that I wanted to lead that was true to my values.
But I think at the same time, it also gave you some perspective on things we typically invest ourselves in at the same time that from this angle don't seem so worthwhile.
That is absolutely true. A lot of the things that the world prizes are not things that I find myself prizing now. A big one there is education. If you go into the room that is sort of the family office, above my desk, you will see all of the diplomas and stuff that my wife hung up over my desk, even though I objected. So there you can see my two bachelor's degrees, my law degree, my license to practice law in the state of Texas. And I look at those things and I am reminded now of how vain they are. And there's nothing wrong with getting an education, but having an education does not guarantee that you will live a well-lived life.
And it's interesting you say that, because there are some typical kind of pursuits, and I know Jeff is already stirring his mind up about Ecclesiastes, because because you know it is probably the book of the Bible that sort of gives us this brutal evaluation of the kind of things.
There are limits to life, and they come whether we want them or not.
Yeah, but and so what then is a meaningful life? And the truth of the matter is that a lot of the things we're giving our time to and investing to are not the things that ultimately give us a great deal of meaning. It's almost like we're living an illusion.
No, it's exactly right. And honestly, I mean, you know, now that you've opened Ecclesiastes and listening to what Matt has just said, I mean, I think it's fair to say, Matt, that you're living Ecclesiastes, which is when death comes, it puts all these other life under the sun values in a completely different perspective, one that Solomon called vanity, the preacher called vanity.
I think that is right. And I'm also reminded of, I think it's Psalm 48 off the top of my head. I'm probably wrong. That talks about you have the rich and the poor. You have the wise and the foolish. And in the end, they're all dead.
Yeah.
That is the brutal reality of the book.
Yes.
It forces us to I think, face the end we ignore. But it seems to me that we ought to know better.
Sure.
Because the evidence of this reality isn't just in the book. It's all around us every day. So as I was thinking about this, I thought about lottery winners. Because I have made a little bit. Have you ever researched the lives of people who win the lottery? I mean, someone that wins millions and millions of dollars. And you would think, boy, that would be it.
Yeah.
If I won $50 million?
I can make that last.
And life would be...
Even after taxes.
You would think of taxes. Life would be, you know, just perfect after that.
Right.
And the truth is, that is so rarely the case.
Right.
That you give people the resources to have essentially anything you could want in this life, and many of them end up not just losing the money,
right,
broken and miserable, and more than one saying, it was the worst thing that ever happened to me. I wish I'd never won the lottery.
And I think part of it, David, and maybe Matt, to pass this back over to you, going back to Ecclesiastes again, is what the preacher tells us in Ecclesiastes, which is, you know, there's this eternity set in our heart. And so that a lot of these intermediate things, even though to your point, David, we should know better, in the actual living of life, we are trying to fill that God-shaped hole with all these intermediate things, but nothing ever really will. And death, or the prospect of death, is the thing that ultimately forces us to face the fact that there's only one thing, one person, there are one being who can actually address all these deepest longings and deepest needs and make sense and give us meaning in a life that is otherwise, for all of us, doomed to come to an end.
Yes, very much so. But it is interesting that even some of the things where I followed my gifts to serve God, even those are not really the things that, looking back, I treasure. You know, I am glad that I preached the gospel. I'm glad that I was able to provide for my family. And I guess if you look at it from a career perspective, I was a successful preacher. But I don't look back and treasure that I was the preacher for such and such church, or that I got up and preached this really good sermon. That stuff doesn't resonate with me either. Interestingly, neither does my writing, really. And that, too, is a gift then. This was something that God gave me to do. And I used it to serve him as I knew how. But at this point in my life, I don't look back and think, man, I'm really glad that I wrote Exalted. That's not the kind of thing that matters to me right now. And, you know, just like preaching, I am glad that I did that. But that to me is not the basis of a well-lived life either.
One of the interesting things as you and I are corresponding about this that you said that I really appreciated is, even in those more noble pursuits, and writing hymns and preaching sermons are certainly noble pursuits, but they're not pathways open to everybody. Not everybody has that gift, the gift of writing or writing a hymn, or not everybody has the opportunity to be a teacher or a preacher. And so if living a meaningful life hinges on those things, then it's going to wind up being closed off to most people.
I think that's right. And it is the beauty of the kingdom of God, the way that God has set things up, that being a disciple, living a life that matters, does not depend on what gender you are. It does not depend on what gifts you have given. It does not depend on your opportunities or your abilities. It's not about any of those things.
Everybody should have the capacity to live a life that has genuine meaning and real purpose that attaches to it.
Yes, I think so. This is something that is open to the very humblest of God's people. That if you look at yourself and you say, you know, I don't really have a whole lot going for me. Whether or not that's true, that fundamentally does not matter, because that's not where life is located. You know, I didn't choose to be someone who is good at public speaking. I didn't choose to be a writer. The only thing that really matters is whether, or the things that we do choose, whether in the moment we are going to live as disciples of Jesus.
You made a comment a minute ago, and this is going to be a little aside. So let me wander off the path for a second. You said at this moment in my life, and of course you're referencing facing a terminal diagnosis. And I think it's easy for the rest of us to say, I am not facing a terminal diagnosis. Folks, we all have a terminal diagnosis. And that's why it's important to recognize this. Well, it really gets back to what you were talking about this morning, this heavenly perspective on things.
Right.
Because all of us end up at that point where we know our lives are going to end. That's not unique to Matt. It is unique to every living thing. Everyone's going to. I had a friend of mine who got a terminal cancer diagnosis, and as he was announcing to the church, he said, you know, I always knew I was going to die, but now I know I'm going to die.
Right.
So the truth is, I think it is an illusion that you got to get the word from the doctor before you're awakened to these things that really matter. And I think that's why your voice is valuable in this, because you remind us of the place that ultimately really we're all in. We're just dealing with very small increments of time.
I think that is true. But there is another side to this even beyond that. I wasn't even thinking terminal diagnosis or not in talking about at this moment, because most of the things that I really look back on that reassure me are things that I did before I knew I was going to die in my 40s. They were choices that I made as part of a life of following Jesus.
Let's go down that path a little bit.
Could I ask you to pause, brother, and wipe at my left eye? Sorry about this, everybody.
We're going to do this periodically.
You got it.
Left eye, that's your side.
That's my side. Oop, I'm losing half of my equipment here. Whereabouts? Is that good?
Take it. Again.
Again?
We should have practiced this.
Am I getting it?
I think what he's saying, Jeff, is that Lauren is way better than this.
Yeah. Yeah,
all right, let's try that. Sorry about that, everybody. One of the unique joys of my variety of ALS is that it makes stuff all over my body inflamed. So periodically, my eyes start feeling like somebody wiped shampoo in them. And that has to get dealt with. So thank you, Jeff, for rescuing me for
sure.
The time being.
We don't want you to we don't want you to be distracted. And I do know that the thing you really wanted to get up and talk about tonight was living a meaningful life and how one does that. And why don't I go ahead and just say that where you wanted to go with that is first by talking about a heavenly perspective. So perspective has been all over our teaching today.
Yes, absolutely. And I think that outside of Christ, it is impossible to live a life that truly matters.
You pointed us to Matthew 22. Why don't I go ahead and add that to the equations? Grab your Bible, head over to Matthew 22.
And y'all are going to be really surprised about what the secret to a meaningful life is.
I'm going to begin at 36, where Jesus is asked, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend the whole law and the prophets." And so tell me what you see there that you found especially meaningful in this discussion.
The interesting thing about my journey with ALS has been that I have come to learn by experience all kinds of things that I had previously known and believed were true from the scriptures. And this is one of them. Because the moments that I look back on in my life that I really value, that make me glad that I did them, are the times when I used the second commandment to prove my commitment to the first. When I worked out my love for God by loving others. That is where meaning in life lies.
So you kind of knit the two together.
Yes, very much so. Because God says, of course, that if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And love for God is... it is expressed in what we say, but it is especially expressed in how we live. And somebody who really, really loves God is also going to be somebody who really, really loves other people and is committed to loving other people. And as John himself says, if you don't love the brother whom you have seen, then how can you love the God whom you have not seen? It is, in practice, I think, very difficult to disentangle those two commandments at all.
So I know the thing that you really are interested in talking about. Obviously, nobody's going to quibble with those two fundamental responsibilities. The challenge is in the executing of them. And so the question is, what does that look like in practice? Loving God by loving others. One of the things that you commented on was the need to look for the overlooked. So why don't you talk about that a little bit? What did you mean when you talked about looking for the overlooked?
In this, I think I am going to start out by telling a story about a woman whom both of us knew. Her name is Marlene Norris. And I have written about this on Facebook before, but it is such a good story that I think it is worth repeating. Anyway, Marlene was a member of the Lord's Church in Joliet, Illinois, where both David and I preached for a time. She was very quiet. She attended faithfully. Never taught a Bible class that I can remember. Never made a comment in Bible class. And she was already an older lady when I moved in. And after some years, she got sick and she died. So the family asked me to perform the funeral. So I show up at the funeral parlor. And, you know, this is a very quiet lady. Nobody expects there to be a whole bunch of people at the funeral. So you've got this whole big room, and there are a couple of rows of chairs set up at the front. And people start coming for the funeral. There's the family there, of course. There are those folks from church who go to all the funerals. You know the type. But then there was this third group, people whose like I had never seen before, people whom I had never seen before. And they were kind of scruffy. They didn't look like they belonged at one of our funerals, but clearly they thought they did. And there were a lot of them. After a few minutes, the funeral directors had to set up another line of chairs, then another, then another, then another, until this whole big room was filled with chairs and people that I've never seen before. And this is one of the best attended funerals that I have ever preached. And I have no idea what's going on. And so I went home and I puzzled over it. And the deal with Marlene was that she had been a lunch lady for an elementary school in the rough part of town for decades. And she loved to feed people.
And she could cook, I'll just throw that in. She was a seriously good cook.
Everybody in that family could cook. But I think that when her family said, yeah, she fed anybody who showed up, what that meant was that she really fed everybody who showed up. That through the decades, her former students, or yeah, I guess we'll call them students, knew that if they showed up at her doorstep, they would be invited in, they would be given a meal. And I would imagine that the word spread throughout all the poor of Joliet that if you wanted a meal and kind treatment, then you just go to Marley Norris's house. And so I think she fed thousands of people during her time. And a lot of those people remembered her kindness so greatly that they showed up for the funeral in hordes. And to me, perhaps the most embarrassing aspect of it all is that I am sure that at some point during my time as a preacher, I got up and I preached a sermon to Marlene Norris about what love was. Certainly, she needed no guidance from the likes of me.
But she epitomizes this idea you talked about of looking for the overlooked.
Yes. People that others would shun, people that we might cross the street to avoid. She invited those people into her home. And people like that are always with us. They are present in the community. and they are present in the church. Every congregation has an in-group, you know, the people who get the attention, who are tied in socially. But every congregation has an out-group too, people without strong ties to the church, people who come even though they don't get much direct encouragement from others. And people like that, by their very nature, we tend to overlook them wherever they are. But I believe that they are especially precious in the eyes of God.
It sounds like what you're saying is we need a third group, a group that looks for the ones that are overlooked.
Yes, I think that is exactly right. That we should be looking, I think, after services, not to talk to our friends, but to talk to the people who don't have any friends.
It seems to me, Jeff, that that is so in line with what we see of Jesus in the Gospels, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
In fact, how often, you know, I remember you and I talking about this when we taught Mark together.
Yeah.
Way back during COVID about how the people who are in
are really out.
Are the outsiders. How often is that the case in the Gospels? How often do we
No, I think that's exactly right. You know, because part of it is, and man, this is a whole nother session, a whole nother sermon, a whole nother evening with Matt. At the end of the day, we tend to look on the surface and God looks on the heart. And if the Bible teaches anything it teaches, you cannot judge the heart by the surface. And so we are often failing to see people the way God sees. And often those who are most desperate and most destitute and most unloved in this life can easily be the most beloved by God because they are the most open to the love of God. Whereas those of us who find love in other places perhaps don't realize how desperately we need and are dependent upon God's own love.
Yeah, you use a word there that I think is exactly right. They're the most desperate. And so, you know, I keep thinking the whole time you've been talking about this, Matt, I've been thinking about Luke 15:1, and where it says the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near to listen to him. I wonder what piece we're missing when people aren't drawn to disciples. I remember having a lady tell me one time, oh, I could never go in your church building. If I did, the whole place would collapse on all of us. It bothered me. It candidly, folks, it makes me wonder how many people drive by on Lueta out here, look at this building, and say, that's not a place I could go. But they didn't see Jesus that way.
No, not at all. I mean, Jesus was the one who somehow took outsiders and turned them into insiders while making the insiders uncomfortable.
Yeah.
And I think that's the essence of it. Because at the end of the day, look, you know, in our society there, I call them, you know, middle class people. Middle class and above in our social stratifications, we tend to be the people who think that we are in control of our lives. The outcasts know that they are not, they're more aware, going back to what Matt was saying earlier, right, about, you know, there's knowing and then there's knowing. And the outcasts tend to be those who know that they are needing God's love more than those of us who think we've got it all under control.
Yeah. The other person I thought about when you were talking about Marlene was Dorcas.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the Dorcas story very much kind of parallels what you've described about Marlene. I mean, culture-wise, societally, Dorcas was a nobody.
Yeah.
She made undergarments for widows. A menial task for a forgotten portion of the population. I mean, I'm talking about a widow in that culture.
Sure, absolutely.
And, but her name is in the Bible.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the things, you know, we forget sometimes, you know, some of the genealogies, you look at all these names of people, and we don't have any of their stories. And one of the things I remember saying years ago in a class on Chronicles, which begins with like 9 chapters of names with no stories, just these are, they mattered to God. God knows their name. And I think that's, you know, a huge wake-up call for all of us when it comes to, you know, Matt's point about looking for the overlooked, is that the people whose names we don't know, sometimes even the people's names we don't know in this congregation, maybe quietly in the way that they're living their lives, be even more known, present, named to God than those of us who think we're doing far more than in the kingdom's eyes we really are.
Yeah. Two things about Dorcas. First of all, like you were saying about Marlene, the people came when she died.
Absolutely.
Because she had made a difference.
That's right.
In their life. And secondly, while maybe only the people she served knew about what she had done, as you said, God knew.
Yeah.
About what she did, so much so that obviously the focus of that story is on the miracle of raising her, right?
Yeah.
And God could have easily said, Peter went to the house of this elderly woman who died and raised her.
Yeah.
But instead, the Spirit chooses to tell her whole story.
Right.
Which isn't necessary to tell about the miracle. Clearly, God wanted us to know about her and what she had done.
Well, and David, we just, and Matt, we've just got to get back to remembering that the kingdom is about reversing virtually everything that we consider to be normal or right in this world. But the world shapes us and considered to be great or important or special. The kingdom is all about reversing all of that.
Yeah.
And by the way, you said that widows were overlooked 2,000 years ago. I think they're an equally overlooked group today.
So I was really glad you brought this up, because I had an experience of my own that really sort of awakened me to the overlooked. I've been preaching almost 40 years, and I've known the whole time I've been preaching that there were parents in my audience who had prodigal children. I've always known that, right? Mm-hmm. And I have to tell you, until you have one, I don't know that you really notice that crowd. After having a prodigal of my own, and then talking, some of y'all who have wayward kids, I just don't think I had any idea about the suffering that the people in this crowd who have wayward children, the suffering that you're experiencing right now.
The suffering, and I think even the shame.
Oh, yes, absolutely, absolutely. And so I began to think about that when I had a prodigal of my own. I started trying to think about how many sermons have I preached to try to counsel and console parents with prodigals. And I could not identify one. So the real thing that came out of that was not just a sensitivity to parents who have wayward kids. The real thing that came out of that for me was, who else am I missing? Who are the underserved among us, the hurting, the suffering, like the outcast of Jesus' day,
right,
that get missed? So you mentioned widows. I had a friend of mine who was married to a wife who was unfaithful and in a very awkward spot spiritually. His connections were really difficult. And I don't know that people thought about that.
Right.
And so maybe we need to have a little more Marlene spirit, a little more Jesus spirit.
Right.
And thinking about the ones that everybody else is overlooking.
Yes, and once you sit down with a pen and paper, it doesn't take long to come up with a list of people in every congregation who often get overlooked.
Well, and part of it is really at the end of the day, listening to what you two have just been saying, is recognizing that we label people or we look at people on their outward circumstances, but the truth of the matter is you don't know somebody till you know their story. Thus, to your point, David, why we're not just told that, you know, Dorcas was raised from the dead or something. We needed her story to understand.
Well, that actually is a nice segue. And yeah. You can be mad at me for taking your list out of order later, but that was on your list. You talked about the importance of listening which I tie to your comment, Jeff, about knowing people's story.
Right.
I think that's a piece of this. Maybe you wanted to go somewhere else to tag on to that, but I'll let you.
I will combine that with the previous point on the list, because I think they're the same thing. The previous point on the list was hospitality. And this was something that Lauren and I love to do and did so frequently for many years. We would invite people we didn't know to share a meal with us, you know, come over to our house for Sunday dinner, and then just foreground them instead of us. Invite them to talk about themselves. Very few people will reject that invitation. And usually, they will tell you what is most important for you to know about them.
So, I'm glad you wrapped those two things together, because I didn't want us to fail to get to hospitality. It's interesting to me, the emphasis given to that in the New Testament, and I'm especially thinking about Acts 2.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at Acts 2 in verse 46, here's the reason I think this is remarkable. So in this little bitty tiny space, what's starting around verse 42,
yeah,
and going down to verse 47,
yeah,
he's going to give us the snapshot of this first church in Jerusalem. He's going to tell us about these people and what's going on with him in this little bitty tiny space. And so I think we forget about that sometime. I don't think these are random meanderings of the Spirit.
Oh, no.
The Spirit has condensed everything that could have been said about the Jerusalem church down to the material,
yeah,
in six verses, mm-hmm, right here. And one of the things he chooses to say is, day by day, continuing with one mind in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they were taking their meals together with gladness and sincerity of heart. The Holy Spirit thought it was vital in his picture of this first church to say they went and ate each other's houses.
Yeah.
So how important must that be? There's something about taking a meal together, isn't there?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, so much so that, you know, on the flip side, Paul says if, you know, someone has forsaken living for Jesus, when he's disciplined, you don't eat with them anymore. The whole idea of that is kind of almost the place in which we demonstrate that we are, you know, loving each other and sharing a common life in Christ, or we have broken that fellowship.
So if it's so clearly a piece of New Testament Christianity, and we are probably, in our prosperous culture, in a far better position to do those kind of things, what's the obstacle for us?
Time. I mean, I think we've chosen to spend our time in different ways than what
and
we used to do.
I think we are in a culture that is not hospitable. And a lot of time, culture wins over the Bible in that we don't make it a priority to invite people we don't know into our homes. And if you put that together with looking for the overlooked, I mean, it's a really simple action plan that any of us with a kitchen table can do. Find somebody on the fringes of the congregation. Invite them over for dinner after services. Get to know them, listen to them. And if you do that, then when you are dying, then you will get to look back and say, I'm glad I showed love to them.
I think that is a really great challenge to give yourself. Because if we do socialize among ourselves, we tend to be drawn dare I say, the in crowd? Can I say that?
Well, Jesus even warned about this in the Gospels, right, David? Don't invite, you know, when you do show hospitality, don't invite over those who are able to repay you. Invite over to your home those who are not capable of repaying you, and then you'll have your reward. Because Jesus, even back in the first century, knew when people got together, they tended to do it with their friend groups and their in groups. They did not. We don't tend to, unless we intentionally do it, we don't intend to expand the circle socially.
Yes.
We tend to either maintain it or even shrink it.
I think that's what it is. It's surrounding myself with people I feel comfortable
sure.
with and not expanding the size of the circle.
Well, and there I put it so crassly, but maybe for some of us at least, part of that is because for us, social interactions are about getting what we need rather than giving what somebody else needs. And I'm not saying, you know, in certain social circles, people won't look out for each other if somebody gets sick or, what have you. But the reality is, when I bring somebody into my social circle, I try to enlarge the circle. I bring that stranger in, you know, the new member or the member who lives on the edges, like Matt was talking about, and invite them to my kitchen table. That takes more work on my part simply because I don't know them. I have to do the work of listening, and listening can be a work. I have to do these things rather than just, you know, picking up where we left off with a group of friends, and it's enjoyable and it's fun and it's recharging to me. And so for a lot of us, we use our social interactions to get what we need rather than giving what somebody else needs.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And by the way, I know that some of you have been chewing on the problem of evangelism. This is a great way to evangelize too. Find somebody in your life with kind of an empty life. Invite them over for dinner. Show them that you love them. And then see how open they are to the gospel. By the end of my time as a preacher, I pretty well wouldn't study with somebody unless I had eaten with them first. You get a lot farther if you eat before you study.
I have found it remarkable how one meal changes a relationship. Just having someone in your house for the first time, getting to know each other.
Yeah.
You just operate on a different level after that. I don't want to leave the listening thing too quick either, because I do think that pausing and asking questions and letting other people talk is really, really important rather than dominating the conversation. And I think there's a lesson in that, at least for some of us who tend to dominate.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, well, you're the tactics man, right? I mean, it's all about asking questions and letting other people do the talking.
And genuinely listening.
Correct.
Reminds me very quickly of one of my experiences at Jackson Heights. There was a guy who had left the congregation and become an atheist. And a couple of years later, he asked if I wanted to talk to him. And I said yes. And we sat around in my office for a couple of hours and talked about some issues that he brought up. And eventually the guy started coming back to services and now is a faithful member of the congregation again. And before I left, he told me that one of the big turning points for him was when he came to me and I listened to him. Sometimes we have this opportunity and we think, oh, I've got to tell them all the things they need to know. Sometimes it's not telling. Sometimes it's listening, because they already know all the things. What they need is to feel like they matter and like you are somebody to whom they matter.
Well, we're getting ready to get a bell that's going to end our time. Before that time comes, I want to say a couple of things on behalf of all of us to you, Matt. First of all, we are all glad that you wrote Exalted, however you feel about it. And secondly, we are thrilled to have you and Lauren here with us.
Yes. And, amen.
And are inspired by both of you in the way you have processed and worked this extraordinarily difficult ordeal that you're going through. We're happy that you're part of our family.
Thank
and really
you,
appreciate your perspective that you shared with us tonight. Let's wrap up with a word of prayer. Let's pray. We're grateful, God, we could be together tonight. We're thankful for the unique view of life that Matt has brought to us. May it help us to live lives that are genuinely meaningful and it impact in an important way your work and your people. Help us to do that, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Number 394, love one another. I don't know what songs you may have been thinking about during this presentation of the last 50 minutes, but these were two that I chose, so if you have some different ones, let me know later on. Love one another, we'll sing all three verses.
Angry words, don't let them never run the tongue, unbridled or say. May the heart that sins ever check their malice for the living. Love one another, just as the angels, till we obey the Father's last command.
How sweet, how heavenly is the sight to those that love the Lord. We'll sing all the verses. Have a closing prayer. Thank you for being here.
One quick clarification. We will have an adult Bible class for those that are attending the VBS so that you can be edified as well. Randy Tumlinson will be teaching that. So be prepared to be uplifted with his words. Lawrence, we'll go ahead and close in prayer.
Let us pray. Father God in heaven, we come before you, Father, with bowed heads and humbled heart, Father, thanking you, as always, Father, for allowing us to come together to hear your word, Father. Father, help us to not to have the mind of a selfish mind, Father, but help us to look on those things of others. Help us, Father, to be more compassionate, more loving, more forgiving. Make us like you, Father. Father, we thank you for Matt, for his inspiration that he gives us all, Father. We ask that you will comfort his family, Father. Help us all, Father, to realize that of ourselves are nothing, Father. For you are our power, our strength. Help us, Father, to not to build up treasure in this life. May we build up treasure in those heavenly things. As we leave this building, Father, if it's your holy and divine will, may we all meet again at the next appointed time. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.